second presentation is going to be by Dr. Ali Aqeel about neonatal tetanus. Dr. Ali Aqeel is a consultant neonatologist and the director of the NICU in King Fahd Hospital, Jizan.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. This is the title of my talk, Epidemiological and Clinical Aspect of Neonatal Tetanus from Tertiary Care Hospital. We have found that from time to time we admit a patient of neonatal tetanus. And that's why we said let us go back and see the cases we admitted before, and maybe we can find something when we study this patient. So we did this work in our hospital. Neonatal tetanus is a potentially life-threatening disease that is still a health problem in many developing countries. It's reported in 2010 and 2013 that the mortality, as you see, 58,000 and 49,000, that's worldwide. The disease is caused by tetanus plasmin. It's a neurotoxin liberated by anaerobic spore-forming gram-positive Clostridium tetani, which is found in many places like the host house dust and soil, feces of animal and even human. The organism contaminates the umbilical cord or its stump following the use of unhygienic instrument or material during or after delivery. Neonatal tetanus is a preventable disease. This is the good thing about it. Maternal tetanus toxoid immunization is the primary prevention, and neonate takes his immunity from his vaccinated mother. In addition to that, delivery in healthcare centers, avoiding unhygienic childbirth practices and some social taboos or customs, and perhaps providing sterile instrument for mother who elect to have home delivery are important preventive measures. Diagnosis of neonatal tetanus is a clinical. This is a retrospective study of all patients who were admitted to the neonatal intensive care unit in our hospital, King Fahd Central Hospital in Jizan, with diagnosis of neonatal tetanus. Babies were included if they were younger than 28 days of age, as per the definition of WHO for neonatal tetanus. Study covered the period between January 1991 to December 2013. All medical records of patients with diagnosis of neonatal tetanus were reviewed to collect information about socio-demographic data, that's including gestational age, birth weight, sex, nationality. Also the immunization status of mothers, location of delivery, attendance at birth by any medical or healthcare worker, and instrument used to cut the umbilical cord. The clinical aspect of the patient were obtained upon admission. That includes sign and symptom at presentation. The management we provided to this patient, which like mechanical ventilation and any medication used for paralysis, sedation, or even convulsion. Outcome of those patients, whether died or discharged, has been recorded, and the neurological outcome or examination for those who discharge alive. We did just simple calculation of rate and percentage. Study was approved by the research and ethic committee of our hospital. The result of this study, we find total of medical record of 30 patients admitted during that period. Total of those patients, 21 of those patients, which is around 70%, were recorded in the first year of the study, like from 1991 till 2000, with about 1 to 4 cases per year and average incidence 0.47 per year per patient admitted to the NICU. The second half, which is 13 years of the period, frequency was around from 0 to 2 cases per year, and average tetanus incidence is 0.19. This is some of the social demographic data, what has been recorded in the medical record of those patients. 28, they are tail, which is around 93%. Two are preterm. 60% of those patients are Saudi, and 76 of them they reside in mountain area, and 26 of them of the mother they don't have any antenatal care, and some just for 13% they have done partial antenatal care, antenatal visit. Around 27. Of patient, which is 90%, they did not receive any vaccination, not tetanus toxoid to the mother, and only 3 patients received 1 dose as claimed by the medical record. Home delivery, around 27, they delivered at home, which is 90% of patient, and surprisingly, that 3 patients, they deliver at health center. Majority, 13 of patient, which is 43, not attended by any means at delivery, and 15, there is no recorded. 2, they said it's attended by midwife. The instrument used is the home instrument used to cut the umbilical cord. It was found in 18 patients, which is 60%, and 40% is not recorded. This is the map of Jizan, the different region. If you see, we are bordering Yemen with a long distance, so patients they come from Yemen to Jizan area, and some of these of the area are mountain area, difficult area. This is a don't worry, I'm not a terrorist, but this is what I want to show you, that people, they use even this home instrument to cut the umbilical cord. The clinical result of those patients, they presented with spasm, refusal of feeding, abnormal posture, and even convulsion. As reported in other report also. 20 of those patients, their birth weight is more than 2.5, and 10 patients, they are less than 2.5. Umbilical is found unhealthy in 27 patients. All patients received tetanus antitoxin, and all patients, they are mechanically ventilated, and 80% receive paralyzing agent, and all patients receive antibiotic. All patients receive tetanus immunoglobulin, but there is wide variation in the dose, which ranges from 250 to 4,500 unit. That indicates there is no standardization of the dose. The complication, 10 patients, they develop pneumonia. Some, they develop septicemia and meningitis. Air leak in 3 patients. And 6 patients died, which is 20% of the admitted patient. And 24, they were discharged. 14 of them, which is 58%, they were normal. And 7 patients, they reported to have mild hypertonia at time of discharge. Neonatal tetanus is a potentially life-threatening disease, still a health problem in many developing countries. It leads to significant mortality, that's by report, 80% of the affected babies die, particularly in areas where pregnant women have poor access to the healthcare system. Actually, since 2009, but I think this is wrong, report to WHO as early as 1990s. The Ministry of Health reporting the neonatal tetanus cases to the WHO, and 40 to 60% of them they are neonatal tetanus of the total tetanus cases. Majority of patients, 60% of those they are Saudi, and 40% were born to non-Saudi mother. Apart from one Ethiopian, all non-Saudi they are from Yemen. Those usually they are not eligible for free health service, and so that's why they are not immunized and they are far from a health center. The fact that 90% of our patients were delivered at home reflects that these pregnant women prefer home delivery but not aware of the complications that unexpectedly may arise, including neonatal tetanus. Majority of the women receive neonatal care, and in 43% they were unattended, and we don't know the situation in 50% of the mother. Educating pregnant women and women of childbearing age in high-risk area during antenatal care is a paramount to raising their awareness of delivery and at health care center, or at least having a trained assistant if home delivery is unavoidable. It seems that counseling on important vaccine for a pregnant woman is not adequately provided by healthcare personnel. The primary healthcare center may not provide sufficient information to pregnant women, particularly regarding the importance of immunization, including the tetanus vaccine. The mean age of patient at the onset of disease was 7.2 days, ranging from 3 to 10 days. Most common the clinical feature, as we listed in the result, it is same, almost the same as reported in other report. Hospital stay ranges from 9 to 73 days, with a mean age of 46.2 days. This long stay was associated in some patients with invasive health care associated with infection like pneumonia, septicemia, and this will add to the financial cost of care of this patient. This is just to show that we spend a lot on treating neonatal tetanus compared to prophylaxis of toxoid or giving education to those patients. If it is the current, those patients, they are treated with, usually we treat them with mechanical ventilation, as per some of the report which find improved outcome if you ventilate those babies. So we found that all patients, they are treated with mechanical ventilation. Six patients, they died. We were unable to determine the direct cause of death by reviewing the medical chart. However, the leading causes are usually respiratory complication and healthcare-associated infection. In conclusion, neonatal tetanus, though sporadic, still exists in Saudi Arabia. Just last 3 weeks, we discharged one patient with neonatal tetanus. The number of cases reported to WHO is small. This has encouraged the elimination of the disease. There is a need for more epidemiological data on neonatal tetanus nationwide. It is essential to start campaign and stress on complete maternal tetanus toxoid immunization at primary health care center during antenatal care. Pregnant women to be educated regarding the importance of antenatal care and the risk of unhygienic home delivery and the importance of immunization. Pregnant women and those of childbearing age in mountains area should be the first target for these activities. Preventive measures should include even illegal immigrants crossing the border, as those deliver in unhygienic situation and they come as emergency to our hospital, so we have to treat them. Proper documentation of the history of neonatal tetanus patient, including maternal immunization and details regarding home delivery and traditional practice after baby birth are essential. Standardized protocol for management of neonatal tetanus is needed to ascertain optimal care of this patient. The limitation of the study, it is a retrospective study. Some data were missing from the patient medical record, for example, information regarding maternal immunization, attendance of the delivery, and causes of death was not recorded. And thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ali. Now, time for questions. Dr. Saleh.
Thank you very much, Dr. Ali. The last time, actually, I saw a case when I was maybe a resident, first year resident. And in Riyadh, yeah. But in Jizan, I know you mentioned, you know, the causes. I would like just to know about, you know, the trend of cases over, I think you started collecting cases from 1991 to 2013, yeah, yeah, right? Yeah. And was it decreasing, increasing, or, you know, doesn't change with the years? Because I need to see, you know, you mentioned that, you know, sort of education is very important. Yeah. I don't know if this is improving with time. So can you tell me about that?
Yeah. By the record, as I've shown actually, in our hospital, that the trend is decreasing.
Decreasing.
But we don't see all patients. Now, hospital in different in other hospital, they can they have intensive care, so some patient may go to those hospital. Unfortunately, we don't find a record at the directorate to see if there is other patient in other hospitals, but in our hospital it is decreasing.
So if may allow me, so the description of your presentation, this we'll call it case series. So when you have a case report or case series, there is a trap that we, first of all, the presentation is excellent. So just want to make sure that I mentioned that. But really, when we're looking to a case series for publication, it should be something novel. So there is a difference between something interesting and something novel. You may have a very interesting case, but there are already 200 reports before you have reported it before, so it's not novel. So this case series are part of this trap. Very interesting, but if you go and look to any book for infectious disease, you will find many, many references on it, unless there is hypothesis-driven, like you are trying to make an analysis association of education, like Dr. Salah was mentioned, education versus instance, or immunization record, or immigration. It has to be some analysis happens. But just mentioning case series, then there is nothing in it. I also would like to mention something in your presentation. I didn't see that much of spelling errors, but the dots, the full stops, we have a problem with it. Mm-hmm. Half of the full stops are exactly on the right. Other half of the full stops, you leave a space before you put the full stop. And then there are some other, there is no full stops. So it just gave me an indication that something had been done in a hurry, a little bit in a hurry. It was not like something you did it last week and revised it twice. So just these fine details, these are the ones that describe what happened. So there is no consensus, or should we put a full stop? When you are doing a PowerPoint presentation, is it sentence or it's considered a banner? So when you are having a banner like here, the 17th annual Saudi, there is no full stop at the end. Why? Because this is not a sentence, it's called a banner, like i'lan. So the PowerPoints, many people consider it's banner. So we are writing, though it is a sentence, but don't put full stop at the end. I think that's more accurate. But if somebody put full stop, then be accurate and consistent. Either you put it, it should be exactly at the end, like at the last letter, followed by a full stop. There is no space in the middle. That, and then also in the conclusion, there are two sentences that start with a small letter, not capital letter. Just something trivial. Thank you.
Dr. Sayyad.
Thank you, Dr. Ali Y Aqee. It was a very nice epidemiologic data from your area. And I think you could actually add some more data to it from the health systems, because the data in itself could be very useful from the point of view of health system interventions and improvement. And as you have shown, that the number of tetanus cases has decreased over the last, say, 10 years as compared to the previous 10 or 15 years. So if you could have also shown us how the system has moved from home deliveries to hospital deliveries over these 25-30 years. Mm-hmm. In this case, you have shown 90% were home deliveries. But what is the overall trend? We don't know. And similarly, you could have also shown us how the antenatal care has improved, how the education of the parents have improved. Of course, this is a multifaceted thing. It's a part of the whole process. So it looks at overall the whole health care of mothers and babies has improved. And if you can put that all together, this will be very useful data and you can make a very good publication in your own local journal. And this may help your own health system very well. Thank you. It's a very good presentation.
Yeah, I don't have actually what you have said, but we are rewarding this because we feel unhappy actually what been done for those for antenatal care, because just as I said, 3 weeks, it was a Saudi baby. The father is Saudi, but mother is non-Saudi, and delivered at home. So we are not really happy with what is being done at the level of the health
care. There will always be some deliveries at home. Even in UK, we have home deliveries.
But,
So it doesn't matter. But I'm talking of the overall trend. The overall trend is to use more and more health facilities and use more and more clean deliveries, and that has reduced everything, including tetanus. Thank you.
Yes, the question from this area. Yes.
Thank you for the speaker. The study is nice, but I see a lot of conclusion. But how did you came to the conclusion that mountain people, they need more of education, or did you prove it in your study?
Yeah, sure. The most of our patient, 27, if I remember, from the mountain area.
Would significantly, statistically significant compared to that?
We're just describing what is there. 27 out of 30. It's a lot.
Dr. Abbas.
Thank you, Dr. Ali. Is this the only study in Saudi Arabia, or we have epidemiological studies on tetanus?
I do not come across any study
concerning neonatal in any other part of the country.
It's a part of describing total tetanus. I didn't see any specific just neonatal tetanus. I didn't come across.
Thank you, Dr. Ali.